So, jetzt wisst ihr also, wen ich gemeint habe, wer da gleich sitzen wird. Das ist Susie von Susie and the Banshees. Hi, nice to have you on our show.
Hello.
Long time no see.
I know. How long has it been? I can't remember.
It was 80.
We played the Lorelei Festival last.
Right.
And the other one.
Well, anyway, I was telling you before that we all love your peekaboo. We think that's a classic. It's going to be anyway. And we wanted to know what it's in the background. You turned something upside down or mingled something. What is it?
It's an outtake of something. It's brass backwards. Mm-hmm. And it's really made it into a tape loop.
Mm-hmm. But you don't know the song where it's from?
Yes, I do, but yeah. I can't tell you.
Tell me. No. All right, okay. It's not one of your songs then?
Yes, it is. It is. But there might be other problems involved in it.
Okay, then we won't reveal it. Es bleibt also weiterhin ein großes Geheimnis. Wir in der Crew haben schon immer gerätselt, was sie denn da bei Peekaboo, dieser neuen Single von ihr, rückwärts genommen hat. Wenn ihr den Song hört, dann wird euch das auffallen. Da sind so komische Geräusche im Hintergrund und sie sagt gerade, es sind Trompetenstöße rückwärts. Und sie sind von einem Song von ihr, aber sie will es nicht verraten, aus welchem Song, weil es da möglicherweise Probleme gäbe. Ich weiß nicht, welches es geben könnte, aber ihr müsst halt weiter raten. Oder vielleicht mal versuchen, die Platte rückwärts zu drehen, obwohl es nicht ganz funktioniert. Where did I start? Gosh.
I mean, that's something we've done before anyway. We like things backwards. I think probably what was trying to be put across is that I think because this group is, me and Stephen anyway, we're very much self-taught. Mm-hmm. Musicians or whatever, without any kind of rock and roll background. Do you know what I mean? We picked up instruments and found how to play them. Mm-hmm. So therefore, that it's quite different working with musicians. So they have to unlearn a lot of things to be able to. I don't know. I think a lot of how people learn music is quite limiting.
Is that the reason why you always had difficulties with your guitar players?
Yeah, they're probably the most proficient musicians, but that their minds aren't that open.
Mm-hmm. So you always had to crack them, sort of.
Yes, suicidal.
Okay. Ich habe sie gefragt, wie das ist. Es gibt da so ein Statement, ich kriege es immer ganz genau zusammen. Auf jeden Fall geht es ungefähr so, dass sie froh ist, dass keiner in der Band richtig im Takt spielen kann und richtig die Instrumente beherrscht. Sie meint, es kommt wahrscheinlich oder setzt es richtig und sagt, also das ist so, dass sie und Steven, ihr Mitstreiter seit langen Jahren, dass sie beide eine sehr unkonventionelle Art haben, an die Musik heranzugehen und dass sie mit ihren Musikern immer eine Schwierigkeit haben, nämlich denen beizubringen, nicht als Musiker zu denken. Das ist auch der Grund, warum sie solche Schwierigkeiten in der Vergangenheit hatten mit ihren Gitarristen. Die wurden also reihenweise ausgetauscht, weil die eben zu sehr wie Musiker denken und sie mussten jedes Mal die sozusagen aufmachen für ihre Ideen. You open up the minds of certain musicians and diverse musicians and with a tin opener probably. On your last album, your new album, I find it remarkably unconventional. Different. You use a lot of very little guitar. There's some other instruments like harmonica and stuff like that.
Accordion.
An accordion. Yeah. How did you find out about these instruments? What made you use them?
I think it's something we've always, in recording, always been interested in sound. And that's always been the downfall when we try to work with different producers, is that we've realized how what a dull attitude they have to recording. They record a certain way and that's it. They don't try different things that they don't know about. Whereas with Mike Hedges, he's like a kid in a studio. It's like toys and he'll try anything. And so with this album, we're working with Mike. And it was before finding John the guitarist, we initially approached Martin McCarrick to join the group, because I think as far as looking for the sixth guitarist, we thought, well, we ought to look in a different way maybe. And Martin's had a very classical background of instruments with cello and piano, but he wasn't accepted within the institution, so he was very much an outsider. And it's really helped us a lot. He's worked with us since Hyena for scoring Dazzle, songs like that. And it was just a very natural choice to think of him first and then look for a guitarist. I mean, I think John's really good, but I think the good thing is that the onus and the pressure has been taken off being the next Banshee guitarist with like a big sledgehammer over his head. And it's very much, it's the guitar's there to add to things, not to be there for the sake of it.
Mm-hmm. So that's in general to the point out guitars and the way you see guitars, because like bands out of England especially, they tend to use guitars a lot.
Yeah, and they have a very one-dimensional approach to the guitar. I like a guitar. A guitar can sound such a variety of different sounds, and yet a lot of guitarists tend to want to sound like, I don't know, Keith Richards or something. It's one aspect. But I really like a guitar that you don't know what it is you're listening to. And I think that's probably why someone like Jimi Hendrix was so exciting, because people didn't know how he was making that noise, and it still is very much his own magic, mm-hmm. in a way, and it's his own creation.
Translating computer. Sorry, I gotta get it this across. Okay, also, die Frage war, wie das ist mit den Gitarren. Auf der neuen Platte tauchen sehr wenig Gitarren auf, generell, und dafür mehr Akkordeon, Mundharmonika und so weiter. Tja, das ist also die generelle Einstellung von Susi Gitarren gegenüber, dass sie sagt, also sie findet es nicht gut, dass Gitarren so klingen oder oft so klingen wie Gitarren. Sie sollten also vielmehr so klingen wie was anderes, das man eben nicht unbedingt weiß. Deshalb mag sie zum Beispiel Herrn Hendrix oder Herrn Richards. Da ist oft was ziemlich Dreckiges dabei. Sie haben im Studio gearbeitet mit Mike Hedges und der ist wie ein Kind im Studio, sagt sie. Das ist das, was sie mag bei Produzenten, die einfach hingehen und wie kleine Kinder an allem Möglichen rumfummeln und rummachen und da eben irgendwelche Sounds rausholen. Sie sind jetzt mit einem Gitarristen gelandet, der im Studio nicht gearbeitet hat. John, der wird auch auf der Bühne dabei sein. There's always been this talk about Susie being the witch of rock and roll somewhere. Yet you say you don't want to have to do very much with rock and roll.
No, not.
What is it you're doing then? Is it you tend to do? You had the phase where you sort of went a bit in the direction of opera, kind of.
No, I really don't. We don't really. We've never limited ourselves in saying we're rock, funk, jazz or R&B. I mean, we draw on everything, but I really hate the rock and roll dead ends that people have. It's sort of like the way we wanted to approach doing this show. We've drawn very much from theatre, as opposed to, I don't know, I just find rock and roll is very much a bravado thing. It's very much a sort of, you know, dazzling people with explosions and loudness, and there's not really that much. I'm much more interested in creating a tension and a slight uneasiness, and to build on that. And I really think you have to simplify things to make that more effective. The show that we'll be doing tonight is it builds. It's not. It doesn't come on and go. You know, it's not like that. I don't like things that do that. I like things to creep up on you.
Sie hat gerade ihr Verständnis von Rock'n'Roll erklärt, beziehungsweise ihr Unverständnis für Rock'n'Roll. Sie sagt, sie macht es nicht. Rock'n'Roll habe irgendwas zu tun mit Explosion, mit Blitz und Licht und etwas mit Schockwirkung. Das will sie nicht. Sie möchte, dass ihre Show und ihre Musik so langsam das Rückgrat hinten rauf krabbelt und dann auf einmal so von hinten übergreift. Das ist auch das, was sie so in ihren Shows versucht zu übermitteln. Also das fängt langsam an und baut sich dann zu einem Höhepunkt auf, ähnlich einem Theaterstück. After this tour, you're going to the States.
Yeah.
How's your perception there? By the audience, you know? You started off later in the States.
I think that, as with most territories, the main drawback is how the record company over there doesn't do things for you or does things for you. It's, I think now just but through sheer persistence, a lot more people are aware of us. We've always had a very big audience in, say, Los Angeles and New York, San Francisco, you know, the direct, but obviously it's the vast country means going to places where, you know, they probably don't even know England exists, let alone who exists. And it's it takes a lot of time, I think, a lot of hard work. And the way to do that is, I mean, say with a band like you too, that and many other groups before them, they actually have to take up residence in the country, and it's, you know, 6 months, years, 18-month tours, and that's something that I don't like to plan my life that much up front. And that's something that I haven't been able to do. It's like a torture, to know what you're doing 2 years from now, where you're going to be. So that's why it's been very slow from us to get to those little towns. But
do you like to make plans for the future, general?
Not in the big, in the main future. Again, I don't. As some people know what shows they're doing in 2 years' time. I like to really live as it comes for the present, not in the past, not in the future, but for now. And
that's enough. That's a statement. Frage zur Zukunft, wie sie ihre eigene Zukunft sieht, ob sie gerne plant. Nein, überhaupt nicht gerne. Das also nicht, mag sie einfach nicht, das steht ihr nicht zu Gesicht. Sie lebt einfach so für den Augenblick. Es betrifft auch die Shows, die jetzt anstehen in den Vereinigten Staaten. Dort sind sie erst wesentlich später bekannt geworden. Das heißt, da ist noch wesentlich mehr Arbeit zu tun. Es gibt natürlich die großen Orte, wo man sie einfach kennt. Ist klar, die Metropolen. Aber so dazwischen, da ist es ja, weißes Land, unbekanntes Land. Da müssen sie noch jede Menge Arbeit leisten. Das mag sie auch nicht so, aber auf der anderen Seite ist es eine Herausforderung für sie. Sie nimmt sie auch an und mal sehen, was daraus wird. Sie sagte, sie hängt natürlich nicht nur von der Band allein ab, sondern auch von dem Publikum und natürlich von der Plattenfirma, die da drüben für oder gegen einen arbeitet.